So, good morning, everybody. Good morning. Having another full house here today, which is always pleasant to see. And I'm sure there's just as many lurking out there someplace. But, okay, so you will have me do a psalm.
106. I'm sorry, number 6.
You've been doing that for a week now. Come on. Okay. A prayer of faith in the time of distress to the chief musician with stringed instruments on an 8-stringed harp, a psalm of David. O Lord, do not rebuke me in your anger, nor chasten me in your hot displeasure. Have mercy on me, O Lord, for I am weak. O Lord, heal me, for my bones are troubled. My soul also is greatly troubled. But you, O Lord, how long? Return, O Lord, deliver me. O save me for your mercy's sake. For in death there is no remembrance of you. In the grave, who will give you thanks? I am weary with my groaning. All night I make my bed swim. I drench my couch with my tears. My eyes waste away because of grief. It grows old because of all my enemies. Depart from me, all you workers of iniquity. For the Lord has heard the voice of my weeping. The Lord has heard my supplication. The Lord will receive my prayer. Let my enemies be ashamed and greatly troubled. Let them turn back and be ashamed suddenly. Amen.
Amen.
Is this still happening?
Oh, yep. Terrible.
Really?
I can't even concentrate.
We can't hear.
It's very high sound. It's ringing all over.
There's somebody,
I hear it now. Yeah.
If you've got a phone on, please turn it off. It's just
phones.
Okay. So nice not to be disturbed by this. You would not hear it up here. You wouldn't hear it. Well, you wouldn't hear it up here. Of course, the rest of us would be going crazy, but nobody would sleep. Think of the bright side. Okay. Opening. The title of this is "Do Things Actually Change?" And that was it was an old opening that I had done years ago, back in 2015, which was just before we were about to launch into something we didn't know we were getting into, which was called MAGA, or MAGA, however you want to say it, movement that gave us 4 years of sanity. And I wanted to reread this to show that we are in Obama Psychodrama 2, Act 1, Scene 1 currently. And though Mr. Marcus, who wrote what I'm about to read, may have seemed like a lone voice back in 2013 when he published it, there are far more folks of the same rational mindset to keep the conservative narrative thriving, well, at least until they censor us all. So January 13th, 2013, American Thinker, which is great if you don't ever read that, just there's really good stuff on there. And his title was Government, America's New God. And the author was Lloyd Marcus, whom you may or may not know. He's been on Fox a bit. And he's known and promotes himself as the unhyphenated American. And he's a keynote speaker for the Tea Party. At least he was back then. So here are his words. I was around 9 years old when my dad took me to see the movie The Ten Commandments, starring Charlton Heston, in the Town Theater in downtown Baltimore. It was a big deal for us because the theater had just begun admitting blacks. Etched in my brain is the scene where Moses comes down from the mountain to witness the Israelites engrossed in an orgy of self-indulgence, celebrating a new god, small g, they created, a golden calf. They had abandoned God to worship a man-made false god. I chastened fellow black Christians for worshiping a false god of skin color, monolithically voting to give Obama a second term despite their awareness of his anti-biblical agenda. However, I have come to realize that the insidious spirit of Antichrist emanating from the Obama administration has spread far and wide. All historical rules for winning and losing elections do not apply to Obama. His political bullying power and irrational status as a cult hero are unprecedented. But here's the kicker and the scariest truth about America's zombie-like loyalty to Obama. On November 6th, 2012, half the country, which includes millions of Christians, chose a Democrat and media-made golden man idol as their new Lord and Savior. Amazingly, actor and Obama disciplined Jamie Foxx admitted that with those very words. While Obama appeared to be the golden idol and focus of worship, America's real new false god, small g, is government, hidden behind Obama's well-crafted shiny gold exterior. The Israelites surrendered the gold items, their inheritance, brought with them from Egypt to build their new idol calf made of gold. In like fashions, Democrats and media convinced millions of Americans to surrender their biblical principles, freedom, and liberty, their birthright, to build a golden idol of government. Many Americans have abandoned God to worship government in a new and supposed all-powerful, all-giving, man-made false god. Dear Lord, help us. The Bible warns that false prophets will arise and deceive many, and that's found in Matthew 24, 4 through 5. Obama is a false prophet. He persuaded millions to vote their vested interest, sacrificing biblical principles, law, freedom, and liberty. I am hearing of more black Christian preachers, pastors, in worship of their new God Obama / government coming out in favor of gay marriage. While Jesus prayed investors and rebuked the coward afraid of investing in the parable of the talents, Obama has demonized investors, branding them as reckless and greedy. From Psalms 128:2, God's words say prosperity is achieved via hard work. And it says, you shall eat the fruit of the labor of your hands, you shall be blessed, and it shall be well with you. And then also in Proverbs 10:4, lazy hands make a man poor, but diligent hands bring wealth. So Obama, in essence, calls God a liar by declaring that prosperity is achieved via government redistribution. So rest assured, Democrats and the media will pull out all the stops to make Obama's second inauguration just short of the second coming, an all hail our king / Messiah spectacular. I wouldn't put it past Obama's official special effects buddies in Hollywood to arrange for his entrance to feature him descending from a cloud, from the heavens on a cloud, as Beyonce and a mass choir sing Hosanna our King. As in the movie The Ten Commandments, Obama's inauguration will be an orgy of idolatry and worship of the left's golden man who is really fronting for their God government. Millions will offer up their tears of admiration. The American left, socialist progressives, are elated. Finally, there is a new God in town, and it ain't the God of Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, or our founding fathers. It is the left's jubilation. Justified, is it? Do a majority of Americans now look to Obama / government to supply all their needs, including deciding who lives and who dies, which you'd find on the death panels buried in the Obamacare bill, rather than the God on which our country was founded? Unquestionably, Obama's reelection has emboldened the disciples to politically bludgeon us into submission of their godless agenda. For example, Obamaites are attempting to bully, punish the Pope and the Catholic Church for not embracing homosexuality. Using typical Democrat tactics of lies and misdirection, Obamaites claim that the conservative had a war on women while hiding their real horrific war on babies. Planned Parenthood annual report showed record profits and a record number of abortions, 333,964 in 2011, just 10 years ago. I wonder if the geniuses who could have come up with a cure to cancer or AIDS were among these who were murdered. Taxpayers, against their will, funded Planned Parenthood with $542 million, further usurping divine authority and sticking his finger in the eye of God. Obama has mandated in Obamacare that Christians will fund abortion and contraceptive services against their faith. My fellow Americans, we are in the midst of a cultural and spiritual war for the heart, mind, and soul of America. Moses asked, who is on the Lord's side? Let him come to me. And Mr. Marcus asked the same. So these are my words now. So things have been layered on top of the finale of the Obama Part 1 story since then. And we did have 4 years of sanity, but now we also have COVID-19 masks and the vaccine layered on top of that. And proven historical science has been completely replaced with an ever-morphing pseudoscience that is driven exclusively by politics and fear emotion. So as an example, I was in Publix the other day, not wearing my mask as I usually, almost always never do. And Publix is a rational supermarket in that they will allow people to not wear their masks if they don't want to. So I had to go to the men's room before picking up a few small items. And having completed my mission there, I was washing my hands at the sink and saw someone come in through the reflection in the mirror. He headed towards the urinal, stopped, gazed at me, and then got involved with what he came to do. So as I threw my paper towel away, he takes a half turn and says, "Put your mask on." So, to which I just gave him a big smile and went my way. So now there were 1,000 things I could have said and probably should have said, but I really wasn't too concerned about that because I believe that in the next several months, there's going to be plenty of opportunities for me to say that to a variety of number of people that are going to try and force that upon me, and I'm sure you as well. So if I may repeat what Mr. Marcus and what my fellow Americans would, we are in the midst of a cultural and spiritual war for the heart, mind, and soul of America. And as Moses asked, and I will now too, who is on the side of the Lord, let him come to me. So, dear Lord Jesus, we know that this world is spinning in an unfavorable direction, but we do know how it ends. And we also praise you for Charlie being in Revelation at this point in time with the daily devotional, which gives us just an idea as to what to and not to expect. And but the focus of it all should be we should be focused on telling other people about Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. And times are fleeting for that. And if your family members, as some of mine and colleagues, and even just people, the neighbors and folks you run into randomly, if they don't know who Jesus Christ is to them as Lord and Savior, it's not going to be a good ride going forward. And we would certainly just like them to have that perfect gift of just believing and then accepting the glory of that comes with it. There's no cost, and it's just a matter of belief. And Lord, we pray for a lot of other folks that we're going to hear about today and that we've learned of during the week that are hurting in a variety of different ways. And yes, this is a fallen world, and yes, there will be trouble. But that guarantee of Jesus as Lord and Savior will get us through any storm here imaginable. And we just pray that that they know that and that those that don't come to it soon. And again, we pray all this in your Son's holy name, Jesus. Amen. Amen.